الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Today inshallah ta'ala we're going to speak about تاريخ الفقه, the history of fiqh. We're going to speak about the history of what? We're going to be speaking about the history of fiqh. Last week we talked about al-khilaf, right? Disputes and differences, right? Now we're going to be speaking about, inshallah ta'ala, the tariq of al-fiqh, the history of fiqh, and the development and the formation of fiqh. So, and we're going to break it into stages. The first stage is going to be Asr al-Tashri'. It's going to be what? Asr al-Tashri'. Asr al-Tashri' means the time in where the legislation was happening. This is from the time when Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent out until he died sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the first stage of fiqh. This is the first stage of fiqh. And at that time, the fiqh was based upon the Qur'an and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Qur'an, at this stage, it was built upon the legislation was coming down, and this was it. The sunnah was sunnah qawliyah, fi'liyah, and taqririyah. Qawliyah means the Prophet ﷺ's speech. Fi'liyah means his action and the Prophet's consent. That was the legislation. That was the tashri'. Nabiullah Muhammad was alive. This was the fiqh. The understanding was taken from the Quran, and the understanding was also taken from where? It was also taken from the sunnah. And when we say from the sunnah, we mean the speech of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the consent. All of them were legislations, and they were the hukum. Anybody who had a dispute at the time of the Prophet, they would refer back to him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the dispute and the argumentation would what? It would settle. Then came the second stage. Then came الطور الفقهي الأول. The second stage came, which was called الطور الفقهي الأول. This was from the period of the Asr al-Khulafa, al-Rashidun, until the 40th year of Islamic Hijriyah. That was the second stage. It was the time of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali, until the 40th year of Islamic Hijriyah. Then came The third stage, المرحلة الثالثة, the third stage, which was, you can all write this yourselves, هو عصر صغار الصحابة. So this is called الطور الفقهي الثاني. This one says طور الفقهي الأول, right? Just change it into الطور الفقهي الثاني. Okay, this is second stage after the Prophet, but it's the third stage including the Prophet's time. This was from the beginning of what? From the young Sahaba, and the senior Tabi'in, until the beginning of the second century. So from the time of, so this time is, this stage is going to be three. It's al-tawr, al-thani. This is asru sigar al-sahaba. Until what? And the kibar al-tabi'in. And the kibar al-tabi'in, until what time? Until the al-qarn awail al-qarn al-qarn al-thani, awail al-qarn al-thani, the beginning of the first century, the second century, sorry, the early beginning of the second century. This is the, then came the fourth level, the fourth marhala. And the fourth marhala is al-tawr al-fiqhi al-thalith. This was the asru al-tabi'in wal-a'imma أئمة المجتهدين. From, so this was the time of the who? This is where the poet said, إذا قيل من في العلم سبعة أبحر روايتهم ليست عن العلم خارجة فقلهم عبيد الله عروة قاسم سعيد أبو بكر سليمان خارجة. فقهاء السبعة, this is where they came from. Do you know the seven فقهاء of Medina? Seven? The seven jurists of Medina. And the A'imatul al-mujtahideen, this is when they started. We'll speak about this inshaAllah ta'ala bi-idhni Allah al-Kareem. Until what? Min matla'i al-qarn al-qarn al-thani, until what? Hatta muntasif al-qarn al-rabi'. So basically, this stage is the Asr al-Tabi'een and the A'imatul al-Mujtahideen, meaning the Fuqaha al-Sab'a. From that time, which is the beginning of the second century, remember? Until when? Muntasaf al-Qarn al-Rabi', halfway in the fourth century. Halfway into the fourth century. That's the fourth one. The fifth one is Asr al-Tadween. What started? Asru al-Tadween. The writing now started. Authorship started. And the writing started. Here, something happened that wasn't present in this, or this, alhamdulillah, all this time. Are we all together? This is the fourth level, right? Am I making sense, brothers? Brothers, are we all together? The fourth levels that I just mentioned, people were taking the Quran and the Sunnah. Knowledge was still strong. When the fifth started, at-taqleed wal-jumud, blind following started. This was called Asr al-Tadween. Authorship started now. All of these people's statements, all of these people's views, all of their quotes now were placed in books. It was being written. So the fifth stage started, which was what? It's going to be Dawru. Which one? Al-Rabi', right? This was Asru. Asru Tadween. Books were being written out. Here, an issue started, which is blind following, stubbornness on opinions, hard-headedness. It started. Still wasn't very, very strong like that. But It started. The sixth and the final one was At-Tawru Al-Fiqhi Al-Khamis. Are we all together? The fifth. At-Tawru Al-Fiqhi Al-Khamis. And this was when the Baghdad dropped. In the Suqut al-Baghdad, when Baghdad got taken until today. When the issue of the Umayyi and the Abbasi and everything happened, this period of time until today is the sixth one, inshaAllah ta'ala. Does everybody understand that? And the sixth one is At-Tawru Al-Fiqhi Al-Khamis. Right, the sixth one, inshaAllah ta'ala. It's At-Tawru Al-Fiqhi Al-Khamis. Here it says At-Tawru Al-Fiqhi Al-Khamis, right? Rabi'. Here is Khamis. When does this start? This started from Suqut Baghdad till today. If you read books of fiqh, this is how they historically divide fiqh into those levels. The fiqh at the beginning was what, brothers? The fiqh at the beginning was Zamanun Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the best of times. Allah ta'ala, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the majority of the fiqh, brothers, where did it really come out? Mecca or Medina? Medina. The fiqh was more stronger in Medina. The hukum and the jurisprudent rulings are more in Medina than it was in Mecca. After the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's time and the time of the Khulafa al-Rashideen, the fiqh didn't go up, it went down. Meaning the knowledge of the religion got divided amongst the people. It wasn't restricted to a number of people, but it was more spread out into other people's minds. Whereas at the time of the Sahabas, there may be one person or two people or three people, individuals who could be said that these were the fuqaha, the jurists. Today many people, if they look at fiqh, they look at fiqh as a what? Shakshakatul aqwal. If the person mentions many different views, this scholar said this, and this one said this one, and this is the view of fulan, and this is the view of fulan, and they think that's fiqh. Fiqh really is not shakshakatul aqwal. Spitting out difference of opinions and who said it. Fiqh is tarjih. Because remember the time of the Prophet where there were opinions. And was it the most knowledgeable time? Was it the most knowledgeable time? Yes, it was. Are we all together? The time of the companions, were there more views or less views? The views became more when? After. Are we all together, brothers? So it doesn't show the fact that you've comprehended and learnt all of the views and you memorized them, that you're a faqih. All you've done is you're just a, you have information. But it's to be able to choose from within those views which one is right, in a correct method. So this time was the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger placed principles. Where did he place principles? The way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed principles alayhi salatu wa sallam was, we're still talking about the first, we're talking about the first time. Okay, we're going back to the first. This time Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave the Quran and he gave the Sunnah. And the legislations were taken from there, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when he died, he left behind principles, qawaid, as the poet said, "Man ihtada bihadihi faqad dhafir, wa man yahid an nahjihi faqad khasir, tulfi bihi ila al-falah makhraja, wa an jami'i al-mu'dilati makhraja." فليس خير قط إلا قرر ولم يكن من شر إلا حذر فديننا لم يخلو عن حكم على مر الزمان لو بدا ما عضلا. Meaning, even though the Nabi Muhammad gave them the Quran and the Sunnah, he gave them qawa'id, principles that they could use even after he dies, that they could bring back things to. Are you with me? فديننا لم يخلو عن حكم على. Our religion has never left a ruling on a particular matter. Everything, إلى يوم القيامة, anything that will bring us closer to Allah and anything that will distance us from the hellfire, our religion has told us a way to achieve it. Are you with me? But how did it do it? Did it specifically mention it? Not necessarily. It doesn't have to. It gave you qawa'id, principles. Principles that you use. Like in these principles, not everybody knows them. فَدِينُنَا لَمْ يَخْلُوا عَلَىٰ حُكْمٍ عَلَىٰ مَرِّ الزَّمَانِ لَوْ بَدَىٰ مَا أَعْضَلَىٰ. Every mu'dilat, every contemporary issue that happens, the Qur'an and the Sunnah have principles in it. So this is what happened. When the Prophet died, Sahabas came, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. Abu Bakr's time, he had to fight with the Murtadeen, the apostates, and those who left. So Abu Bakr was more focused on that. So at his time, Abu Bakr didn't shine and come out with his fiqh, ma'a ilmihi, with his knowledge, and he's the most knowledgeable of the companions amongst them all. He was, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But at his short time, Abu Bakr was the leader. He was focused on what? Those who refused to pay the zakat. So he was busy with administrating that particular conflict. Are you with me, brothers? But you tend to find more fiqh from the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar was speaking more on ahkam fiqhiyya that was brought to him, and qadha and issues like that, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Here, a new form of reference started that wasn't present at the time of the Prophet, which was what? At the time of the Prophet was only Qur'an, and here there was applying a concept called al-ijma'. Ijma' didn't exist at the time of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, because the Prophet is there, there's no need for consensus. But after the Prophet died, the Sahabas were using consensus because they found it in where? They found it in the Qur'an and the Prophet's statement. The Prophet ﷺ said, لا تجتمع أمتي على ضلالة. My ummah do not unite upon misguidance. And the Qur'an mentioned the concept of consensus. Are you with me, brothers? So here started the consensus. Sahabas would agree on a concept. Are you with me, brothers? If you look at Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, you find something very powerful, which was the concept and the shi'ar, the banner of following the kitab and the sunnah was so strong at the time of Abu Bakr and the Khulafa al-Rashideen. Look at Abu Bakr, for example. When they said to him, take Usama ibn Zayd and take him off the army. Usama was only what? 16 or 17. Are you with me, brothers? 16, 17. This is a big army. Some people have refused to pay the zakat, Abu Bakr. Are you with me, brothers? Right now, do you think it's sensible? Do you think it's right for 16? Abu Bakr came out with one of the fundamental principles of fiqh, which was shi'ar al-tiba'. He said, the Prophet did it. Nabiullah Muhammad placed this individual, Abu Usama, and made him the leader of the army. I cannot come and take him down. Who am I to take him down? Are you with me, brothers? And Abu Bakr placed a principle which is the masalih and the mafasid are set by Allah and His Messenger. Are you with me, brothers? The benefits and the good is set by who? These were fiqh incidents that the Sahabas were very clear in. Does that make sense, brothers? You tend to see that. وَلِذَلِكَ I advise each and every one of you to read the kitab إعلام الموقعين by Ibn al-Qayyim. Which kitab? إعلام الموقعين. This book, Shaykh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, he said, it's the book of Islam. And it really is, wallahi. It's a book full of... For all of this I'm saying to you, the overwhelming, nearly all of the and more, you'll find it in I'lam of Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala. How the history was, how it all happened, where did it all come from. Usul al-fiqh and how it came each principle that you see that is being used, what brought it about, the foundations of the madahibs, all of that is in its book, in his kitab I'lam, Ibn al-Qayyim's I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So this time was shi'ar al-tiba. It was the era and the timing of following the sunnah, following the Qur'an, and also making sure that no one goes against the consensus of the ummah. At this moment, everything was just memorized. Everyone was memorizing the statements and the quotes. Nothing was written. And then what happened? Some of the scholars, they suggested that some things get written. Especially at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, writing became more prevalent. Writing became more prevalent, it became more clear. ولذلك, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he did command people to write at his time. May not be as much as Uthman's time, but look what he said to Muhammad ibn Amr ibn Hazm. He said to him, "Unzur, look at ما كان من حديث رسول الله." Look at the ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ. فَاكْتُبْهُ write it. فَإِنِّي خِفْتُ Abu Bakr is saying this. I am scared. دُرُوسَ الْعِلْمِ That knowledge may go. وَذِهَابَ الْعُلَمَاءِ And the scholars might pass away. So write things down. This is who? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. But again, as I said, it wasn't as clear as it was the time of Uthman and then even after that. Here what happened was, the Khulafa al-Rashideen, they passed away, and this era started, which is Sigharu Sahaba. They were the young companions in age, but great and but senior in what? But senior in knowledge. They came. وَلِذَلِكَ there's a risala, I advise you again to read. With the Ilam al-Muqi'in is a risala written by Ibn Abd al-Barr. The risala is called Fuqaha al-Amsar. Risala, something Fuqaha al-Amsar. Huh? What's it called? To be honest, I was meant to bring it today, but Allah did not create it. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. I was meant to bring it. This kitab is called something Fuqaha al-Amsar. The jurist of the world. He mentions every tabaqa, every level, who were the fuqaha, from the companions of the fuqaha, the tabi'een, the tabi'u tabi'een, until the madhahibs came. And within the madhabs, the students of the imams of the madhabs, are you with me, brothers? That kitab and the kitab by Ibn Qayyim is very good for you to read. His one's very small, Ibn Abd al-Barr. You can read it between Dhuhr and Asr. Like Ibn Qayyim's one's volumes. What is it? That's volumes. Okay? Am I making sense here, brothers? So that you can go back to the names of the sahabas that I'm referring to here and the tabi'een. The tabi'een here, who also dragged into this time, are seven. I want you to all research. I mentioned the line of poetry, إِذَا قِيلَ مَنْ فِي الْعِلْمِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ رِوَايَتُهُمْ لَيْسَتْ عَنِ الْعِلْمِ خَارِجًا فَقُلْهُمْ عُبَيْدُ اللَّهِ عُرْوَةٌ قَاسِمٌ سعيد أبي بكر سليمان خارجة. These are who? These are the فقهاء السبعة, the seven jurists. All of the companions' knowledge, it got united in these seven men. Okay, in Medina. Are you with me, brothers? And they were called the seven jurists. فقهاء السبعة. Are you with me, brothers? The knowledge of those فقهاء السبعة, it went into. Again, you guys have to find those names and do your research. Those seven, their knowledge, it went into the hearts and the minds of the four a'immatul arba'a that we have today. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Malik, Al-Imam Shafi'i, and Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal went into them. Are you with me, brothers? Because who did Al-Imam... Al-Imam, for example, Malik take from? Al-Imam Malik took from who? The scholars and the fuqaha of where? Medina. He did, right? He did. He took from the fuqaha al-Medina. And who took from Imam Malik? Shafi'i took from him. And Shafi'i, who took from him? Ahmed ibn Hanbal. So all of them would go back to where? The fuqaha of Medina. Then came the Asr al-Fiqh al-Thalith, which is the Sahaba's time, until the Aimatul Mujtahideen. Aimatul Mujtahideen, here are who? The four Aimatul Madhab, Shafi'i, and etc. And then came the 4th century, which is after these Imams, Asr al-Tadween started. What started? The 4th stage, which is now all of that knowledge which is out there, writing it, documenting it, putting it inside books. Okay, this time the authorship was broken into three types. Write this down. The authorship was in three types. The authorship was tadwinul fiqh, tadwinul fiqh. Fiqh was written mukhtalita bis sunnati wal athar, but it was mixed with the Prophet's sunnah. It was mixed with what? The sunnah of the who? So it wasn't pure fiqh. It was like the fiqh and the athar, meaning the quotes of the Prophet ﷺ and the companions and all of them, and the fiqh was side by side in the one book. Okay? And these are the books of the sunnah, right? Huh? Kutub sunnah. The second one was, so for example, don't think to yourself you're not going to get fiqh from Bukhari. Are we all together, brothers? Are you going to gain fiqh from Sahih Bukhari? Ha, la shakka wa la raib, you will. Sah? Are you going to gain fiqh from the Muwatta of Imam Malik? Sahih, you will. La shakka, you will. Are you going to gain fiqh from the Musannaf ibn Abi Shayba? La shakka, you will. But it's not a big book. You're not going to say it's a fiqh book. Are you with me, brothers? It has fiqh in there, but it's mixed up with what? It's mixed with hadiths, it's mixed with athar and sunnah. The second type is al-fiqh mujarradan. Just fiqh now. Just pure fiqh. No hadith and no athar. And that's how the books that we see today, like Mukhtasar al-Quduri and the kitab Mukhtasar al-Khiraqi, which was the first Hanbali book written. And if you look at Minhaj of Imam al-Nawi, it's a whole book you're reading, but there's no hadith or ayah in there. The Imam is just giving you, what's he giving you? He's just giving you the summary and bullet points. The explanations are going to give you the evidence for each point. Are you with me, brothers? This was what? Tadwinul fiqh mujarradan. The fiqh was written, stripped from hadith, stripped from the athar. Number three, تدوين الفقه مع أدلته. The fiqh was written, but the evidence were also mentioned with it. This one is what you would call al-khilafiyat, or you now they call it al-fiqh al-muqaran. What's it called? Comparative fiqh. Comparative fiqh, where basically this view's evidences are brought, and this view's evidence are brought, and they're cross-checked, and then which one is stronger? Like you see, for example, in khilafiyat of Imam al-Bayhaqi. Like you see in Al-Mughni by Ibn Qudama rahimahullahu ta'ala. Are you with me, brothers? He's bringing the fiqh and he's bringing the evidence for it. That started. Like in the first one was, hadith and fiqh were running besides one another. Then, they said, no, we need fiqh only in this book. That was the second. And the third one was what? And the third stage was? Huh? The fiqh with its evidences. At this stage, what happened was Asr al-Tadween, al-Taqleed, blind following. What happened? Blind following. And al-Jumud, stubbornness, started to occur. This is in the Asr al-Tadween, the fourth level. Asr al-Tadween, al-Taqleed wal-Jumud, it started. Until what? Muntasaf al-Qarn al-Rabi', until the middle of the 4th century, meaning until Suqut Baghdad, until Baghdad dropped, the blind following and the stubbornness started to come. People were very hard on their opinions. People started to give more importance, a lot of importance to the views of the fuqaha. They started to give importance to the mutun. And we'll speak about that inshaAllah ta'ala. Every madhab, each one we're going to speak about. And Imam Abu Hanifa and the books regarding him. We're going to speak about who? Imam Malik and the books regarding his madhab. And then we're going to do the same for Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala. We'll speak about each one inshaAllah ta'ala. But this time, at-ta'assub, at-taqleed, which was not present before that. So people started to have stubbornness. Until the view started to happen, which is people wouldn't marry each other off. So a Shafi'i would not marry his daughter to a Hanafi, and a Hanafi would not marry his daughter to a Shafi'i. All based upon what? Ara fiqhiyya. To some extent it reached takfir. What did it reach? Takfir. And even extremism, ghulu. Like the poet said, إن الهداية قال القرآن قد نسخت ما ألفوا قبلها من ما ألفوا قبلها من شيء من كتبي فاحفظ قواعدها واسلك مسالكها تسلم مقالك من زيغ ومن كذب. He's trying to praise the kitab al-hidayah by Marghinani, and he said the kitab al-Marghinani al-hidayah is like the Quran. It abrogated all the books, mean all the other fiqh books. He said فاحفظ قواعدها, memorize the principles that are in it. واسلك مسالكها, take its path. تَسْلَمْ مَقَالُكَ مِنْ زَيْقٍ وَمِنْ كَذِبٍ. You'll be saved from any mistakes and any lying. Meaning your fiqh will be precise. This is a Hanafi book, it's not the Qur'an. He's trying to say that this kitab is correct, verbatim, word for word, nothing's wrong. And if you go against Al-Hidayah, you'll be misguided. Are you with me, brothers? And things like that you tend to see. تَعَصُّبْ madhabi. People were dying and they were on their deathbeds and they would say, أَنَا شَافِعِيُّ مَا حَيِّتُ فَوَصِيَّتِي لِلنَّاسِ أَنْ يَتَشَفَعُوا. I'm a Shafi'i. And I'm going to be a Shafi'i as long as I live. And I'm advising every one of you to be Shafi'i. They were writing it in their wasaya. They were writing this in their what? In their wasaya. It reached that point. وَلِذَلِكَ It's still, till today you still see that. I remember some messages in the UK, forget villages down in Somalia, yeah? UK. I'll do a khutbah in a masjid. From the minute they see me, they're like, we're Hanafi. We're Hanafis. And then they tell you, as soon as you come in, they'll tell you we're Hanafi. They say, okay, no problem. When you sit to do the khutbah, to do the pulpit, before the muadhin does the adhan, he tells you, Hanafi, okay, just make sure. Like whatever you do, wallahi salaha. So everything, you have to do it according to what? The Hanafi way. The two madhabs that really went against each other specifically were the Shafi'iyya and the Hanafiyya. Because to be honest, the Shafi'iyya and the Hanafiyya were the two madhabs that were really the qudat. They were the judges. What were they? They were the qudat, the judges. Like, generally, nobody else was a qadi except what? No one was a qadi except who? Qadi was only either a Shafi'i or he was a Hanafi. I listened to a lecture by Sheikh Abdul Salam Shuwair. He was good in fiqh, mashallah. Very grounded in fiqh. And he was talking about why the Hanabila were not... Do you guys know Sheikh Abdul Salam Shuwair? Who knows him? Put your hand up. He mentioned why the Hanabila were not qudat. Why they didn't end up being qudat. And he brought the kalam of Ibn Aqil rahimahullah ta'ala, and he said that the reason was because the Hanabila, whenever they attain knowledge, they turn towards Akhirah. They became ubad worshippers. They didn't like manasib positions. Remember the Qadi Qudat. The Qadi Qudat, it's a mansib dawli. It's a governmental position. He can imprison you. He can exile you from the land. He has authority. He's not just a mufti in a local masjid. Are you with me, brothers? Qadi Qudat is a big, it's a high leveled ranked position. It's a governmental position. Are you with me, brothers? When you're hearing Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah got arrested and he went behind bars and he got, and the Qadi Qudat were arresting him. They were behind it. They passed a fatwa that says he's arrested. Are you with me, brothers? Am I making sense here? So the Qadi Qudat is a position. It's a position of authority. Strong position of authority. And so the majority of them was the Hanafi and the Shafi'iyah. Walidhalika, that's why you find the Kutub and the Khilafiyat, majority of it is directed more towards the Hanafi and the Shafi'i. Walidhalika, Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni's father, the author of Al-Waraqat. You guys know Al-Waraqat? You know Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni, right? His father, Abu Muhammad al-Juwayni, Abu Muhammad, Abu Muhammad al-Juwayni, you have to remember one thing. Are you with me, brothers? He's from the Ashabul Wujuh in the Shafi'i Madhab. Like, the father is more stronger than Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni. Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni is not as powerful as his father. His father is a man who has his ikhtiarat, his opinions, it has a position within the Madhab Shafi'i. Are you with me, brothers? They're called Ashabul Wujuh. His father is from Ashabul Wujuh. We'll speak about that when we come to the Madhab of Imam Shafi'i. So Abu Muhammad al-Juwayni has a kitab which he wrote against the disputes against the Shafi'iyah and the what? The Hanafiyyah, and where they differ and who's right and who's wrong. And after that, the Shafi'iyah still couldn't recover from the, because the back and forth arguments were too much. They were what? They were too much, until Abu Muzaffar al-Sam'ani, who? Abu Muzaffar al-Sam'ani came, who was 30 years a Hanafi. And I think 20 years or something like that, he was a Shafi'i. So he repented from being a Hanafi. And he became a what? He became a Shafi'i. So what did he do? Because he was the inside man. He knew everything inside and what the construction was, the building and everything he learned. So when he came, he had one of the best refutations of the Hanafi madhab. His kitab, Qawatu'ul Adillah. Are you with me, brothers? In Baghdad, at a time, it reached gold, his book, for the Shafi'iyah. Are you with me, brothers? Ala kulli hal, this period and this time was ta'assub and jumud, stubbornness and hard-headedness. Then the Khilafah of Baghdad, Baghdad dropped until the 10th century. The fiqh carried on that way, the way that we mentioned. But this time, some scholars came out. Who came out? Some scholars came out. From them, some scholars who try to walk away from this taqleed and this jumud. Okay, brothers? And they work towards ijtihad. And they argue there is ijtihad. Just want as a side benefit, from the kitab At-Tahadduth bi Ni'matillah by Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. Jalaluddin al-Suyuti's time, he claimed that he was a mujtahid mutlaq. Suyuti said, I am a mujtahid mutlaq. Okay? So everybody listen. I'm a mujtahid mutlaq. And the people, they got angry, because at that time, remember, blind following was set. No one was allowed to go out of it. Al-Jumud, al-Ta'asub is still present today. Suyuti said, everyone, I am mujtahid mutlaq. Leave me alone. Then they said, we want to debate with you. And he said, how can a mujtahid mutlaq debate with a muqallid? It doesn't work. A muqallid has to only follow what he's told to him. Because the muqallid is like a what? Mayyitin inda mughassilin. It's like a dead body in front of the one that's washing it. His hand is picked up and everything. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's dead. So only person who can debate with me is a mujtahid like me. And the people who are judging have to be what? Mujtahideen. If they say, okay, we'll bring a mujtahid that's going to debate you, and a mujtahid that's going to be a judge, then the debate won't even happen, because they agree that the mujtahid mutlaq does exist. Are you with me, brothers? But the point is that this point, when Baghdad dropped, there came some scholars who worked towards ijtihad. From them being Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. Ibn Taymiyyah, who died the year 728. Ibn Taymiyyah came, and his student Ibn al-Qayyim came. They were mujtahideen. But we have to understand that they, of course, they studied the madhab of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and they mastered the madhab, and they learnt it very well. And then after that, they walked away from it. When I say walk away from it, I meant the blind following. But they did take the madhab if it was correct in the opinions that it was correct in. Also, Imam al-Nawi came. Imam al-Nawi is not a Shafi'i. In all of his books, he goes against the madhab. He refuses issues in the madhab. And we'll speak about how do we reconcile between what Nawawi says in his Sharh of Sahih Muslim and what he says in his other books of the madhab. How do we reconcile between it? We'll speak about that. Ibn Hajar came, rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Kamal ibn Humam. Many people don't mention him. Many people don't mention him. They don't mention him. But he's al-Hanafi. And truly, he's the author of the Kitab Fath al-Qadir. He has ijtihadat within the Hanafi madhab. Mujtahid. He goes against the madhab sometimes in great issues. So even that, though this era was still taqlid, was prevalent and it was out there, but there came out afdad min al-ulama'i, a number of great scholars. And the last stage that we mentioned from the stages was the stage that was سقوط بغداد إلى العصر الحديث to our time. So we mentioned all the levels, right? We spoke about all the levels. Inshallah ta'ala, next week we'll talk about the conditions of being a faqih. And we're also going to speak about the issue of following a madhab. Next week we're going to speak about كيف تكون فقيها. How can you become a faqih? And we're also going to speak about the concept of التمذهب. We're going to speak about what? The concept of التمذهب.